Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'm going to introduce you.
Oh, please.
It's my pleasure to introduce a young man who I think many of you know.
We just met, actually.
Some of us know better than others. Aaron Klaus grew up right here in Tapamaica, became bar mitzvah here. He is a proud graduate of the Oberlin College and Conservatory of Music, and currently a student at Towson, pursuing his master's just this past Tuesday evening. He presented this program, as well as a little more partial fulfillment of his requirements for his master in music. And he's accompanied today by the fabulous Alina Antonenko. Without further ado, I present Aaron Klaus.
Thank you. Welcome. I'm so grateful to be hosted today by Temple Mica. It's a place that I've been honored to call my home for my whole life. Thank you also, especially to Rachel Gross for all her help in putting this together, and of course, my dad for all his help as well. While this performance is the culmination of a research project in Jewish music that I began last June, its roots go back many years. As a synagogue musician and camp song leader who's also classically trained, I have deep roots in both liturgical music and in secular music. During my conservatory studies, I began to wonder how both of those musical realms could enrich my soul despite existing as two distinct entities in my life. My realization of this dichotomy led me to two big questions. One, how do composers' vastly different Jewish experiences affect the creation of their music, be it liturgical or non-liturgical? And two, what makes Jewish music Jewish anyway? These enigmatic questions reveal the challenge of defining Jewish identity. Nevertheless, we can begin to find some answers in the world of Jewish art music. First, what do I mean by art music? Is not all music a form of art? Well, art music, as it is generally referred to, designates music that descends from classical practice, so in the form of symphonies, operas, sonatas, concertos, and the like. The term is commonly used in contradiction with folk music, popular music, and liturgical music. In Western Europe, the impetus behind the development of Jewish art music was emancipation, a process throughout the 19th century where Jews who had previously existed in insular self-governing communities within the nations of Europe were granted equal citizenship rights. While emancipation perpetuated ideas such as liberty, tolerance, and brotherhood, the many preceding centuries of Jewish isolation had cemented barriers to integrating Jews into modern society. As a result, Jewish composers had to choose between working inside liturgical traditions or outside liturgical traditions. They couldn't do both. Composers who worked inside, so liturgical composers as we know them today, which included Solomon Sulzer, Samuel Naumburg, and Louis Lewandowski, wrote liturgical music in a European idiom. In fact, you may be familiar with one of Sulzer's most famous melodies. I'd like to play it for you. Of course, if you've been here or anywhere else on a Saturday morning, you know that what follows is his Shema Yisrael, also written by him. So there's this heritage there that we still take a part in today. So Jewish composers who worked outside liturgical traditions, including Felix Mendelssohn, Giacomo Meyerbeer, and Jacques Offenbach, wrote secular and sometimes Christian-inspired music for European audiences, thereby rejecting Jewish liturgical traditions in their art. For these composers, their longing for acceptance and belonging triumphed over their longing for distinction, as they recognized that the only way at that time to be accepted into the European public cultural milieu was to avoid wearing their Jewish identity on their proverbial sleeve. Meyerbeer and Offenbach became giants of the opera, while Mendelssohn was a true European romantic composer. Emancipation, as I have described thus far, was largely a Western European phenomenon. And so while Western European Jews were focused on assimilating into secular society, Russian Jews were becoming increasingly isolated at this time. This isolation, combined with violent pogroms, fostered a Jewish nationalistic bond, which for many developed into a longing for a return to Zion. This yearning spread from Russia to the rest of Europe, and as Jews began to migrate to Palestine, they endeavored to create a culture in the spirit of this new land. The musical aspect of this culture is referred to as the Eastern Mediterranean School. It's a combination of European musical traditions with folk traditions of Jews of the Middle East, especially that of Yemenite Jews, which emerged in the British Mandate of Palestine. The power of this combination for nation building and culture creating lay in the nationalistic sense of the authenticity of this music. Jewish emancipation in Europe failed to achieve its goal of assimilation. It took 150 years for Europe to attempt to assimilate Jews for the sake of equality, only for Europeans to realize that the structure of society barred Jews from maintaining dual religious and secular identities. As we all know, this process ended in the entire Jewish community of Europe being wiped out or leaving. Although, thankfully, in a sense, there emerged a new two-pronged model for Jewish existence in the world. First, the first prong, American pluralism, which we are all a part of, allows Jews like us to freely express our religious identity while simultaneously taking full part in modern society. Second, modern Israel allows Jews to exist cradled by the spiritual connection to their ancient homeland and the imperative for religious self-governance. This new model is the miracle of modernity. The art music that emerged in the process of achieving this miracle is of utmost interest to me, and it is what I would like to share with you this morning. We will start right in the midst of the emancipation process, the mid-19th century. So it would be impossible to understand the evolution of the Jewish identity of the composer of my first piece, Ernest Bloch, without first understanding the gargantuan influence that Richard Wagner exerted on European music. Richard Wagner, a German composer who lived in the 19th century, saw himself as the true heir to Beethoven in the lineage of European composers. Why Beethoven? Well, Beethoven exerted perhaps the greatest influence of any composer in history, largely because his music was so grand and profound, but also because he was the first to introduce the idea of universal brotherhood in his music. The text of the iconic Ode to Joy in his last symphony comes to mind. It includes the line, "All men become brothers," which are words that perpetuated the idea of Beethoven as a universal composer. That is, one whose art reaches all of humanity. Wagner became obsessed with that idea, and through his massive-scale operas, he believed that he would achieve the ultimate universality that Beethoven was aspiring to. Wagner argued in his 1850 essay, Judaism in Music, that true art is rooted in the living language of a people and in that language's reflection of a historical community, which Jews could not lay claim to, according to Wagner, in their diasporic state. However, Ernest Bloch understood this idea differently. As a Jew born in Switzerland and educated in France and Germany, Bloch never felt a sense of national belonging, which he so longed for. After all, he was a great admirer of Wagner, who stressed the importance of race and nation. In his music, Bloch attempted to construct the idea of Judaism as a race, using a Jewish musical language through which he believed he would achieve the universality, he would reach all of humanity in a way that Wagner sought. The irony, then, that came to define Bloch's life was that his conception of Judaism as a race developed out of Wagner's anti-Semitic ideas. Regardless, he was the first and most widely known composer to declare his non-liturgical music to be Jewish in nature. In 1918, Bloch went to the New York Public Library to research Jewish melodies. This research helped to cement the basis of what I refer to as Bloch's Jewish musical markers, which are musical devices that Bloch could insert into his compositions to make them Jewish. These Jewish markers symbolized his idealized view of Jewish racial purity, the idea that Jewish people refers to a set of shared biological roots, not of shared religious beliefs. I'd like to highlight two of those markers for you, augmented intervals and shofar calls, which are prominently featured in the piece I will perform for you shortly, which is called Proclamation for Trumpet and Orchestra. So an augmented interval is simply when the space between two notes in a musical scale is augmented or made wider, specifically by a half step. So you take a typical sounding scale that might sound like this. I'll play it for you. And then you widen augment one of the intervals, one of the spaces between those notes. It becomes a very different sound. Listen. So this is a sound that we are all familiar with. It's a sound that's inherent in the soundscape of European Judaism. It's the sound of Hava Nagila and so many other melodies just like it. And Proclamation, it makes its appearance towards the end. I'd like to play it for you. Towards the end of that little excerpt. So, is this scale, to put it simply, inherently Jewish? The famous Jewish musicologist, Abraham Idelson, notes that, quote, the fact that this scale is not used for the Bible and for the ancient prayers leads us to the opinion that it was originally unknown to the Jewish people. Essentially, he's saying that Hava Nagila may sound Jewish to us, but there's no connection for the sound of Hava Nagila to the ancient Jews. And furthermore, he goes on to say that this is not a sound that's inherent to Jews throughout the world. I think truly there's no answer to the question of whether or not Bloch's use of this scale makes his music Jewish. Now, the importance of shofar calls in Judaism is certainly more self-evident. Moreover, the fact that the shofar is mentioned in the book of Leviticus makes it one of the few definitive links we have to the music of ancient Judaism. It's no wonder, then, that Bloch features prominently two shofar motifs in Proclamation. The first one is reminiscent of a tikiah call. Here's how it sounds. The second one is reminiscent of the sliding or sound of the shofar, like a gliding sound. In music, we call it a glissando, and it sounds like this. And these are ones that, if you listen, you will hear throughout the piece. It sounds like this. So Bloch's legacy is complex because he found his Jewish voice in the idea that the path towards universality lies in one's racial identity. This idea is inherently problematic for Jews because our peoplehood cannot be explained simply in racial terms. Instead, each Jewish composer's identity is more complex and intricate than can simply be assumed from the label Jewish. Ultimately, I would argue that in studying music by Jews, it's more meaningful to celebrate the unique Jewish experiences of individuals than it is to artificially impose unifying characteristics to their music. In doing so, we dispel the Wagnerian myth of racial purity by recognizing that the uniqueness of each person's life experience, not their genetic makeup, shapes their identity. Bloch's life shows us that imposing definitions on others' identity limits understanding, creates barriers, and justifies prejudice. With that in mind, here is Bloch's Proclamation.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I forgot to thank at the beginning myself. I know you mentioned her, but my amazing accompanist, Alina Antonenko, she's been just, I could not have asked for a more wonderful collaborator through this whole process. This is actually the third time we've presented this at a couple different locations, and she's been really wonderful. So thank you so much. So we've seen how Bloch's music was largely a reaction to the influence of Wagner. This was not the case for Italian-Jewish composer Mario Castelnuovo-Tedesco, though, for several reasons. One, Italians, who took great pride in their long operatic lineage, reacted with xenophobic trepidation to the influence of Wagner in the world of opera. Two, anti-Semitism was not salient in Italy during Castelnuovo-Tedesco's childhood, as Italian Jews had long been integrated into modern society. Nevertheless, Bloch and Castelnuovo-Tedesco both desired to express a link to the past through their music. For Castelnuovo-Tedesco, the impetus to write Jewish music came in 1925, when he discovered a book of liturgical melodies written by his maternal grandfather. This discovery left a deep emotional impact on him, and he embarked on a project in which he transcribed traditional Sephardic Jewish melodies as sung by his mother. Castelnuovo-Tedesco was also a student and admirer of Bloch. Through his study of Bloch's music, Castelnuovo-Tedesco incorporated Blochian musical markers, such as augmented intervals. His second trumpet sonata, which I will perform for you, contains augmented intervals in the second movement. Again, you kind of hear towards the end of each of those little excerpts that sound. However, now, the rest of the piece does not contain any other noticeably Jewish elements. Instead, each of the movements is based on a Renaissance or Baroque dance form. So, is this sonata a piece of Jewish art? The piece bears no explicitly Jewish title, such as his 1928 Chant Hebraic, nor does it contain any liturgical text or biblically inspired themes. Furthermore, it contains no clear musical references to anything he found in his grandfather's book or any other Italian Sephardic melodies. Is the presence of the augmented interval that I just played for you enough to make this a Jewish piece? If it is, then could you make the case that the incessant repetition of simple melodic motifs with little variation, as you will hear throughout this piece, is a reference to the simplicity of Italian Sephardic liturgical music? I will leave you to draw your own conclusions. Regardless of what those conclusions may be, the fact that Castelnuovo-Tedesco's strongest Jewish musical influences were from the 1800s further dispels any myth of a continuous historical link dating back millennia. His music, even his explicitly Jewish compositions, was a product of the greater context in which he existed. I'd like to finally add that in all likelihood, this is actually the first public performance of this work. Castelnuovo-Tedesco wrote this second of a series of two trumpet sonatas in 1955 when he was living in Los Angeles. For reasons unknown, they were never published and never recorded. However, they exist in manuscript form in the composer's hand at the Library of Congress. I'm very grateful to Diana Castelnuovo-Tedesco, the composer's granddaughter, for granting me permission to photocopy and perform this second sonata.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So, at the beginning of this presentation, I mentioned the Eastern Mediterranean school of Israeli art music, which emerged when European Jewish immigrant composers in the British Mandate of Palestine created music that fused European musical traditions with Middle Eastern folk traditions. The Eastern Mediterranean style is characterized by irregular rhythms, obstinate repetition, and a monotonous, even sometimes hypnotic character. At the forefront of the movement to create this music was Paul Frankenberger, who would Hebraicize his name to Paul Ben-Haim when he emigrated from his native Germany in 1933. He came to Palestine in the midst of the fifth great wave of immigration, the so-called Fifth Aliyah, in which over a quarter of a million Jews, mostly from Central Europe, emigrated in order to escape persecution. With such a large and rapidly growing population, Jewish settlers found arts and culture, especially music, to be particularly effective tools for creating national unity. Unable to find work in Germany because he was Jewish, Ben-Haim immigrated to Palestine in 1933, where he would fortuitously meet the Yemenite-born singer Bracha Zafira. Zafira grew up surrounded by Yemenite, Sephardic, and Persian Jewish music, and in 1930, she decided to study in Germany, where she met her husband. Together, they arranged many of the melodies that she grew up with for voice and piano. I'd like to play an example of one of these for you. This is a song called Yesh Li Gan, I Have a Garden, as sung by Zafira herself. After Zafira and her husband divorced, she sought out new collaborators, including Ben-Haim. Between 1939 and 1949, Ben-Haim served as Zafira's accompanist and arranger. She introduced him to her large repertoire of Yemenite melodies, which profoundly influenced his compositional output for the rest of his life. The piece that I'm about to play for you, Three Songs Without Words, is representative of the Eastern Mediterranean school. The first two songs, Arioso and Ballad, are soft and pastoral, speaking to an idealized view of the land, and are reminiscent of the piece sung by Zafira that I just played for you. The last song directly quotes a Sephardic melody. Ben-Haim writes of this piece, quote, "Whoever's imagination needs additional prompting may think that the long-breathed melodies of the Arioso were inspired by the mood of a summer day's pitiless heat in the Judean hills. The ballad pictures the monotonous babbling of an Oriental storyteller, while the last song is a traditional tune of Sephardic Jewish origin, a veritable pearl which I have only given a setting." Three Songs is not just a microcosm of Ben-Haim's body of work, but also of a snapshot of the young country's nascent musical style.
Thank you.
I'd like to return to the questions that I posed at the beginning of this program. First, how do composers' vastly different Jewish experiences affect the creation of their music, be it liturgical or non-liturgical? The key phrase in that question is vastly different. I've tried to show through this music that there is no historical continuum stretching from the music of the ancient music of the Israelites to 20th century Jewish art music. Therefore, the monumental variety of Jewish music that exists in the world is a direct result of the monumental variety of Jewish experiences that individuals have had across time and space. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, what makes Jewish music Jewish anyway? In 1957, musicologist Kurt Sachs famously proclaimed that Jewish music is written, quote, by Jews, for Jews, as Jews. Can we apply that litmus test to the pieces I've presented today? First, the music of European Jewish composers. Bloch, in labeling himself as Jewish, yet writing in a non-liturgical idiom, could never, for many Jewish critics, be Jewish enough. As a result, he felt increasingly estranged from the Jewish community, which led him to indicate in many of his writings that his music was a personal endeavor, not meant for them. Therefore, his music contradicts Sachs' definition. In the case of Castelnuovo-Tedesco, some may argue that he composed for Jews to inspire them in the face of growing anti-Semitism in the 1930s, but that claim is dubious, given the lack of evidence to support it. Certainly, in the case of his not specifically Jewish compositions, like the Trumpet Sonatas, that argument becomes even weaker. Second, the music of Israeli Jewish composers. The Eastern Mediterranean school catered to the Zionist narrative by employing musical markers from Middle Eastern folk traditions that connoted aboriginality, simplicity, and collectivism. Again, here, the music is a product of its era and of the experiences, motivations, and aesthetics of its creators. The music of Ben-Haim and many others was written by Jews and probably written for Jews, but it was not just written as Jews. It was written as settlers, as Europeans, and as Zionists. Given these complications, I assert that any attempt to define what makes Jewish music Jewish will ultimately be fruitless. The compositional output of each of these individuals comes from a tangled web of identities and life experiences. The music I've presented today is only Jewish insofar as its creators and its audiences have asserted its Jewishness. I'd like to leave you with one final question. Why does this all matter? After all, the music of Israel pre-statehood served a socio-political purpose relevant to its time, and the Jewish music of Western Europe was born out of a community that no longer exists. It would be frivolous to present a recital that's akin to a museum exhibit. What does it mean to us today? Why do we listen to old music at all? I want you to think back once more to the final movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. In fact, I'd like to play an excerpt for you. And as I do, I want you to note any visceral reactions you might have. This is one of the most frequently played pieces in the world today, still even 192 years after its completion, because its ideas endure. The concept of brotherhood of man still resonates today, All the more so because Beethoven forces us to pair that idea with our visceral reactions, which for me include, when I listen to this, sheer joy and elation. The enduring idea of the music of Bloch, Castelnuovo-Tedesco, Ben-Haim, and so many others is that the struggle of conflating religious and secular identities is the struggle of every modern Jew. Each one of the composers I presented today grappled with how to be both Jewish and European, or Jewish and American, or Jewish and Israeli. What does that struggle look like for us today? The questions are endless. How do I honor Shabbat when the world around me keeps moving on Saturdays? What do I do if I'm asked to go to school or work on Yom Kippur? What if my modern values, ethics, and scientific understanding contradict Scripture? Should I wear a kippah or jewelry with Jewish symbols in public? Is it still meaningful to keep kosher? I submit that our challenge of assimilation will ultimately lead us towards individual and collective experiences that are richer and more meaningful because it forces us to question who we are, thereby hastening the evolution of our identities. The struggle of these composers are our struggles. That is the enduring idea of this music. Thank you. It was a true labor of love and a wonderful experience, very personally meaningful experience. Do you need the sanctuary next? Do we have time for questions? Or yeah,
a few minutes.
I would be more than happy to take any questions. Yeah.
How did you learn about the existence of this?
That's a great question. The question was, how did I learn about the existence of the Tedesco sonatas, given that it was not actually published? So as you can imagine, programming a recital of Jewish art music for trumpet is quite challenging. Planning a recital for trumpet in any genre is challenging in the sense that think how much music out there is for solo piano or violin, and not so much for the trumpet. I do appreciate, as an aside, playing the trumpet allowed me to talk about things like shofar motifs that is not as much present in piano music, for example. But to answer your question, I'm always interested in finding new music that I had not heard of by Jewish composers. How did I find it? It was in one of the books that I was looking at for my thesis, and I saw that name and just Googled him and did a little investigation. And the Library of Congress is great with how they catalog all their works. Lucky to live very close to there. Went on down. I had to email his granddaughter, but it was. I'm very glad I got to do it. Yeah.
Describe more about his other works and his life. Other than this piece, something about him.
Yeah, I'm still learning about him. The question was, can I describe more about Tedesco and his life? I don't know too much. What I do know is, he was born in Italy, and I guess at that time very much was able to be sheltered from the rising anti-Semitism that was kind of happening elsewhere in Europe. When Mussolini rose to power was when things, got tough for him, and he actually moved to L.A. He actually is well known as a film composer, and so that was kind of how he made his mark. He has some specifically Jewish composition. He has a sacred service that he's written. So some specifically Jewish compositions. He has a violin. His first violin concerto is called The Prophets, and it's based on the prophets. So some, but a whole lot of seemingly explicitly secular music. So yeah. Was Copeland? Yeah. Well, I think it speaks to, again, the challenge of delineating or demarcating, where your Jewish identity ends and where you as a secular composer, where's the boundary between those? Some might say that if you're Jewish, then your music is going to be Jewish because that's, you just can't help it. I don't necessarily agree with that. He was one of probably the most well-known from Los Angeles at that time to be writing explicitly Jewish music. But again, you know, a lot of his music was not that, you know? And so it's, the answer to your question becomes a little gray because of that, so. So, in the back, yeah. No problem. That's a great question. So where has the Eastern Mediterranean school gone